Good morning, and can I apologise for the slight delay in the start of this meeting this morning, which is the 13th meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. I note that we have apologies from Edward Mountain, MSP, but in his place today we are joined by Sue Webber, MSP. Morning, Sue. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Are we agreed that items 5, 6 and 7 can be taken in private? These are the future consideration of the Code of Conduct rule changes, the draft report on future parliamentary procedures and practices, and consideration of a revision to the directions to the Ethical Standards Commissioner in Scotland. Are the members agreed that we can take this in private? I am grateful. Items 2 and 3 we are going to postpone to a future meeting, time to be agreed, which takes us to agenda item 4 on the future parliamentary procedures and practices. And I welcome to this evidence session Artemis Panner, the National Coordinator for Scottish Rural Action, Bill Scott, Senior Policy Advisor for Inclusion Scotland, Chara Scott, Promotion Engagement Manager with Christians Against Poverty, and Mari Wiley, the Chief Officer of the Highland Third Sector Interface and TSI Scotland, TSI Scotland being the body of charities that support the third sector across Scotland. And those witnesses are joining us online. Good morning. And here in committee this morning, we have Liam Fowley, former or now former MSYP for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley, but also the former Vice Chair of the Scottish Youth Parliament, and also Kimberly Summerside, Policy Engagement Officer for Voluntary Health Scotland. Can I welcome you all this morning? And for those who are joining us online, can I remind you to press an R in the chat function on the blue jeans if you would like to come in on any of the issues. I am hoping that this can be in the form of a round table where we can get some conversation and discussion through me so that you can help with the report that we are in the process of preparing. So I'm going to kick off, and I'll probably kick off, if I may, with you, Artemis, and work through those witnesses who are joining us online before inviting those in the room to contribute, to ask to what extent do you normally engage with the Parliament and how has it been different since COVID? So the enormous question about what we've been through in the last 18 months and how that's in sort of affected your interactions with the Parliament. So that's with regard to frequency of engagement on issues, who it was that you engaged with, committees or otherwise, and also the ways that those engagements happened. So good morning, Artemis.
Good morning, Martin. Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for this opportunity. My organisation, Scottish Rural Action, acts like a platform to connect our members to decision makers in government at all levels, so local, Scottish, UK, European. Our members are individuals, many with lived expertise of intersectional issues, and we also have members who are organisations, development trusts, businesses, second tier, all with an interest in rural and island affairs. Now, as I said, we're a platform between our members and those in power. Members normally engage a lot with the Scottish Parliament and through all available mechanisms, including petitions, briefing to MSPs, committee appearances, cross-party groups, and also activities that are facilitated through your in-house participation and communities team. Since COVID, what as an organisation, we've kind of been looking at and we feel is important to examine are three aspects of parliamentary proceedings. The first aspect is in relation to the number and types of participation entry points. So as the Parliament website says, how do you get involved in Parliament? And in that respect, we have found that most participation entry points remain about the same. So petitions, electronic briefings to MSPs, committee proceedings, and apologies, I'm looking away, I'm just checking my notes here. Online consultations, cross-party groups, they've all remained at similar levels. What we have found is that many publics fell off your radar, and we would strongly urge this committee to examine the potential positive impact of these in the context of your current inquiry. And also on a very, very positive note, we found that entry points, so participation opportunities that are facilitated through your participation and communities team have increased. So things like virtual site visit, briefings for your committee members, focus group consultations, things like that. And those are invaluable and should be built on. So that's the first aspect in relation to the ways that you get involved in Parliament. The second aspect is accessibility. You have these entry points, but are they more accessible because of COVID or less accessible? I suppose from a rural and island geography perspective, most of these entry points became more accessible due to a move to online proceedings. And this is actually interesting to us because though hybrid approaches were used in committees before and cross-party groups, and these pre-existed COVID, it is really the normalization of online proceedings that has helped, because before people would think, oh, it's not really socially acceptable to not turn up to Parliament in person and would make a choice accordingly. I think normalizing online has made this online participation a lot easier, and also probably hastened some technological advances that make these experiences a lot better, like today. Clearly, there's still a lot of barriers that are generated in this process. So barriers for our members are in relation to those who do not have good broadband access or IT skills or indeed technology within their home, those living with caring responsibilities or with a disability. And so we do need to talk about the level of support and flexibility for those members of Scottish Rural Action and also members of the public. Very, very quickly, the third aspect
Artemis. My apologies for. My apologies for speaking across you. It's certainly the intention of the committee to look into those aspects later mm-hmm. on at this round table discussion. It was really just to capture your experience over the last 18 months or so. And I had a question that went in my mind, and it's completely slipped out on something you said. So there we are, my deepest apologies. So if it's all right, Artemis, I may well come back to you on that when it comes back into my addled brain.
Absolutely.
No problem. Bill Scott, could I ask you for the same with respect to your experiences from Inclusion Scotland's point of view over the last 18 months?
Very, very similar to Artemis's point of view on this. In many ways, the move to online has assisted disabled people in participating in parliamentary business, in particular contributing evidence to committees. For disabled people, particularly in rural areas, the journey to Parliament could be so energy sapping that they just wouldn't even consider it. Even if accommodation was provided and things like that, or whether social care needs are really high, again, coming to Parliament was really quite a difficult and strenuous experience. So I think it has opened up participation to a whole range of disabled people who otherwise wouldn't be able to take part. It's good, though, that there is, with the move back to face-to-face meetings as well, because there are quite a large proportion of disabled people who are not online. And so the option of appearing in person is still good for them, because they wouldn't otherwise be able to take part. And we, myself, probably in the Parliament every other week normally, and I think I haven't been in the Parliament on business now for over 2 years, and I will be attending for the first time next week a committee session. It's been a really good experience online. I think tech has worked generally very well. What I think we miss a wee bit is the informal chats with MSPs when you're maybe in visiting one MSP or coming in to give evidence to a committee. Quite often there's a chance just bumping into somebody in the cafeteria or on your way to and from a meeting, and it's missing those opportunities, I think, where you build up relationships with MSPs and parliamentary staff. That's what's been missing from the online experience, I think.
That's very helpful, Bill. Thank you. Charis, what comments would you have about the experiences of the last 18 months?
Yes, so I think for us at CAPS, we provide debt advice. So we have a network of debt centres across Scotland. So we work with people predominantly that have a low income across Scotland. And before the pandemic, we didn't have many opportunities. Parliament, we would take part in consultations and work with local MSPs where we had debt centres to raise awareness and have referral processes through that as well. But actually for us, the pandemic has opened a lot of opportunities to work with Parliament. And I think there's probably a couple of reasons for that. Partly the issue of poverty and debt has become more in the public awareness and radar over the last couple of years because of our collective experience. And an openness to the input of faith groups as well and the work recognition that they are doing across Scotland at this time. So for us over the last couple of years, we've had the opportunity to take part in work with the Committee for Social Justice and Social Security, particularly on their low income and debt problems inquiry. We've done that both from a perspective of our experience and expertise, but also in facilitating experts by experience to take part in those kind of sessions as well. And then in our involvement with the cross-party group on poverty as well. So, and that kind of openness, having the hybrid options for us has been a real positive experience on the whole. There are still issues that others have highlighted there around barriers, but it has opened up the opportunity for people, regardless of location or caring responsibilities, to take part in Parliament where they wouldn't have previously.
Thank you, Charis. That's very interesting. If I can come back, do you feel... I don't know whether you can answer this in a sense or whether or not about those the access, but do you feel it's more your Parliament over the past 18 months because of that access to a wider group of MSPs than perhaps your experience before that?
I think it's certainly heading that way, and I think certainly for the people we've worked with that have taken part in Experts by Experience sessions, that's definitely a growing feeling for them of feeling heard and feeling valued in their experience and being able to make a difference, and the desire that they don't want anyone else to experience what they have. So they're then motivated to take part and they have felt really valued by that experience.
Thank you for that. And if I can turn to you, Mari, coming probably from as far afield as anyone, how has the last 18 months and the experience been for you with that interaction?
Thank you for including the TSIs in this today, and obviously I'm pulling significantly from my own experience based up in Highland, but also bearing in mind the wider experience across the network itself. In a lot of respects, in terms of this specific issue, the experience has been quite positive, actually, because in the past, certainly the perception that I would say from our more remote and rural colleagues across Scotland is that we've tended to draw on individuals within the Central Belt to participate in issues connected to the Parliament or an engagement more broadly with MSPs around specific issues. I think what we're starting to see now is that people aren't having to make decisions about trying to evaluate the value to some extent of attending the Parliament. So, for example, if I wasn't doing this digitally, I would have had to have come down last night. I would have been at the meeting this morning, and then I would have had to travel back. And that represents quite a significant amount of time away from other activities. And so you have to make an evaluated choice. What the participation, and I couldn't agree more with Artemis's point about the normalisation, because people in Highland, people in remote and rural communities of Ireland are not unaware of the fact that we could join in previous to March 2020 digitally, but that we actually had to make an evaluated choice about whether or not that participation was going to really work, because we've sat in meetings where it hadn't. But actually what's socially acceptable now is very different to what it was then, and that's been a really positive change too. So I think overall what we're seeing is people are able to participate in much more normalised way from more remote and rural communities. We're seeing the ability to engage people who maybe are closer to subject experts rather than trying to channel that expertise through other individuals who are closer. So all in all, I would say actually it's been really positive. And one of the things I would point out is that we've had some really good engagement from parliamentary outreach, etc. But the fact that we can do that digitally, so it's not just about us participating into the Parliament digitally, but with the Parliament participating with us digitally, I don't feel as guilty in asking an individual, whether that's an MSP or whether it's a member of parliamentary staff, to participate with us, because I'm not asking them to make a 6.5-7 hour journey and potentially no next day. So actually, it goes kind of both ways, and it's nice not to feel so guilty asking them to participate for a little while as well. So I say overall it's been quite positive, acknowledging all the barriers that I'm no doubt that we're about to go into and that others have already acknowledged as well.
Thank you. You should never feel guilty about demanding your MSPs to do work. Don't worry about that. thank you. Kimberly, if I could come to you. Experience over the last 18 months?
Yes, so just by way of a bit of background to Vaunch Health Scotland, we're an intermediary organisation and network for health charities and other voluntary organisations working in health. And the core purpose of our organisation is to tackle health inequalities and improve the health and well-being of the population. So by nature of that purpose, we do engage with Parliament over a number of portfolios, but primarily the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. And for the last 7 years, we've been secretariat to the Health Inequalities CPG. So the Health Inequalities CPG is definitely what we engage with in Parliament the most. That has moved entirely online, as I'm sure you're aware. We largely see the same number of people attending, but we don't have to cap attendance, which is a big thing. In the past that would have had to be capped. We don't have to cap anymore. And we're getting about the same number of MSPs attending as well. It is worth saying that engagement is harder to engage that number of people. So if you're talking about 60 attendees online, it is not the same experience as it was in person. But as other witnesses have already said, that engagement is far wider now. We're managing to reach people we weren't before. And the one thing with the Health Inequality CPG that has been missed is the annual reception. That played a really big part in creating networks and communities, not just with MSPs, but, you know, within people working to tackle health inequalities, played a big networking role. And then the other big area of engagement with us is the participations and community team as well. They have so many great things to say about them. They really are fabulous. And I think their role can't be understated in actually engaging Parliament with communities and managing to get communities into Parliament. So with them, we link up our member organisations and other stakeholders with Parliament, but also they provide learning for our members and our Health Policy Officers Network as well on how to engage with Parliament. So they really are great. And then beyond that, it's, you know, mainly committee clerks and engaging with the committees as well.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much. Liam, your experience?
Yes, morning. thank you. And thanks for the invite today. So, first part of the question, as the democratically elected voice of Scotland's young people, I suppose is a natural link to link up with the Parliament that's the democratically elected voice of people. So that's been really strong over the past 20-odd years, and over COVID it has actually improved as well. I think there's been a bit of a common theme that the participation in communities team are absolutely superb, and they do have a vital role in the Parliament, and they are very effective at taking feedback as well, which is really important, and what's not going right and where we can improve. And they have actioned that feedback and have probably showed quite a lot of good examples of youth participation and coming back and saying this is what we've done to change things throughout our experience as well. We have a partnership agreement with the Scottish Parliament that the presiding officer has again signed, which I'm of course grateful to again, and that's again improved the relationship between SYP and the Scottish Parliament. And over COVID, when we were all online, that was clear because there was an additional kind of effort made to get times that suited young people, because that's the really important part. And I know we're going to come on to it later, but the biggest issue, I think, is definitely to do with the timings of Parliament and how you will operate during working hours, if you will. And young people will probably be or should be in school or college or work, etc. So that is a massive barrier there as well. We are moving towards the legally binding incorporation of the UNCRC. Got to get that in there, and we're getting there slowly, which is fantastic to hear. We're getting to that point. I think you said earlier, is it your Parliament? And I think we are certainly getting to that point, and young people are certainly getting to that point that they feel that this is a Parliament that represents them. There is a lot more work to do, and I'm glad that this sort of inquiry is happening.
Thank you very much, Liam, and thank you all for your contributions. I'm now going to invite various members of the committee to ask questions. And as all conveners say, across the whole world, I have now discovered, not everyone needs to answer the questions. But if you have something you would like to contribute, please, as I say, put R in the chat function or indicate through me. Tess, could I turn to you, please?
Thank you, convener. So this question, I'll ask it first, and then if I'll invite each person to say something if they'd like. So the question is, what in your view are the positives about the changes the Parliament has made to its working practices? I know we've covered, so if we, Artemis first, you talked about normalising the online experience, but a negative about broadband. But if you could just think about a few of the positives from these working practices.
I think an enormous positive is something that was mentioned by Mari and others on this committee today, and that is a step culture change towards recognition of civil society organisations as partners to Parliament in facilitating public engagement rather than a replacement for public engagement, if that makes sense. So our job as civil society organisations is not to speak on behalf of people with the real expertise, it's to give platform to people with lived expertise. And that understanding, which the Scottish Parliament Participation and Communities has, that you need to do that extra step, that extra effort to ensure meaningful participation working with civil society organisations, has been kind of quite remarkable over the last 2 years, and it has been facilitated by a move to online online models of delivery.
Bill, would you like to go next?
Sure. I think very similar. I think that disabled people have been participating in the Parliament's activities possibly more than before the pandemic, and that's quite surprising given the vulnerability of so many disabled people to COVID. Otherwise, they would have been trapped at home and many situations, you know, isolating because they were vulnerable in the first year, and they were actually able to take part in the Parliament's proceedings. Just add our voice to those of the other organisations. The participation team in the Parliament has been excellent. I think they've really done a good job in supporting people who've taken part in evidence sessions with committees. And I think that's something that really needs to continue, because I think it's that before and after support that's really, really important to people. They want to feel that by giving evidence they've made a difference, and I know the work of committees is really important in terms of influencing what government does and doesn't do, and therefore, you know, knowing that a committee has listened to them and taken on board their views, and that it is there in the committee report and in the questions to ministers that the committee puts to ministers when they give evidence, all of that is valuable in demonstrating to people that they have a genuine voice. And like the other organisations here, you know, the real experts are those with lived experience. And we've been trying to get that message across for years, and I think the Parliament has taken it on and really does value the voices of those at the sharp end of policies and government action or inaction. So I think it's been a very positive experience in those terms, and long may it continue. I hope that Parliament continues to involve people the way it has over the course of the pandemic.
Thanks, Bill. So you talked about being real positive experience, and also the option to appear in person, so the hybrid. So thanks, Bill. Caris, would you like to go next?
There's a couple of things that we would highlight really as positive experiences that we've had. I think we've seen a real shift in an openness, like Bill was saying, to the experience of those who have lived experience and their expertise in the area. We really want to highlight the work of the Committee for Social Justice and Social Security in their recent inquiry into low income and debt problems as good practice, in that they've worked very closely with ourselves, with Inclusion Scotland, to make sure that the experience of those experts has been a positive one. It's been accessible for them, the flexibility in terms of video platform as well. So we've been using Zoom for that to make it more accessible for people, which has been a real positive thing. The other thing for us would be recognising that experience in terms of paying those experts by experience as well. So we would highlight that as a real positive step forward. So our clients have taken part in that, have been paid for their time as a recognition of their expertise. And I think that's a real positive step that we would love to see and advocate for continuing as we go forward as well. And just, yeah, having that kind of flexibility. I think for us as well, working to find ways to overcome the barriers to digital exclusion as well. So I think there's definitely more we can do on that, but we are seeing positive steps in the right direction for that as well by working with us to make sure that our clients have access to digital equipment, broadband, things like that, in order to be able to take part in different evidence sessions.
Thank you, Caris. Mary, would you like to go next?
Yeah, just a couple of points, conscious of time as much as anything else. I suppose, as I said, a lot of it is very, very positive. I think from my side of things, it's the idea that I feel as though the Parliament is more accessible based on my own experiences, but also on the feedback that we're getting. But it's more important than that. I think that the impression that certainly I'm getting from the people that we're now seeing participating within parliamentary inquiries and in events such as this, is that you're getting a much broader input. So you're not necessarily seeing as many of the well-kept faces, as in that the information that's coming through from the groups that Artemis described as the civil society. So those, the channels for information flowing into the Parliament are much broader, probably much more accessible, and they're certainly taking account, I think, of a wider spectrum potentially of views, which is all positive. And I think that probably leads to a more inclusive approach. The only thing I would highlight, though, is I think Bill's point around the lack of ability to build the relationships up. So when you all came into the room today, I suspect that you probably spoke to one another. I hope that you did, and that you exchanged. And actually, we don't necessarily get that opportunity through participating digitally.
My next question is going to be on the negative. So I've captured those two about, conversations before and after the meetings. Kimberly, if you could highlight some of the positives, please.
Yes, so I'd largely agree with everything that's been said so far. I won't labour the points about how much this is, it increases the third sector's involvement in Parliament, because as resources are stretched, it's far less resource intensive to actually engage, you know, online. Takes an hour out of your day as opposed to the entire day. So from that point of view, we're finding our members are really enjoying the ability to give evidence online. And from a capacity point of view, in terms of, as an organisation, we organise a lot of events in collaboration primarily with the Participation and Communities team. And so just to give you sort of a real example, for the Health Inequalities Inquiry, which has just kicked off, we were able to participate and organise 4 events over the course of 2 days, all online. And that those events at Sue was at those events had multiple breakout rooms. So there were our organisation's breakout room was primarily other organisations working in health, but the other organisations that they collaborated with were, you know, bringing experts by experience, lived experience into the room as well. So that was a really vast project over the Friday and the Monday, and it wouldn't have been, I don't think we would have reached that many people had it all been in person. And I think that's a really good example, because of the scale of it and because we were in breakout sessions, online works really well, I think. There weren't the barriers that you face sometimes with CPGs being huge, big, vast rooms that not everyone can contribute to. So that just really increased our capacity to actually be able to contribute to those events. Much wider engagement and capacity and resources would definitely be the main things for us.
Great. Thank you, Kimberly. I'm just the word that Mary used was almost digital equals participation, you know, subject to people having the broadband, etc. Thank you, Kimberly. Liam.
Thank you. I won't labour any points, as I know every convener in the world's a demon on the clock. So in terms of what's went well is the disruption to young people's lives. I know it has been touched on, but I think it is really important to solidify that. Real-world example, I'm currently interrupting my education to give you evidence today. So there we go. So it does give it a really key, and obviously, as an organisation, we always hand forward young people with the experience they have, whatever the inquiry be or whatever the session is, because that's really important that you're hearing directly from young people. But that does require the disruption from school, from work, from college, plus all the travel time, and it has been mentioned about the rural aspect. That was kind of almost halved by the digital element. We've had people given evidence in, you know, one of their back of their school classrooms, for example. And yeah, it was a slight disruption, but it's a significant improvement. And that kind of links on to the thanks as well, that there's been more sessions over COVID directly for young people, because that's really important as well. It's only young people, a couple of members from a committee on a Teams call, and provided that, as you said, provided that all young people have that digital access, that's a significant improvement on previous experience where you have to come into a room like this, which, no offence, is a wee bit intimidating for some young people. It's not a personal dig, but, you know, lights, camera, big tables, things like that. And that is a significant element. And if you think about it, if you pop onto an online call, you're just going on, you're on you go, you have a chat, and away you go again. Totally different experience. That also comes with support. So you can sit on a Teams call, and if you're panicking or whatever, you can have a text with someone who can support you as well. And that's a really key element, because people might freeze in that environment. So it's really important. There's also the Your Views platform now that the Scottish Parliament has. That's another vast, you know, it's brilliant, I think, because young people can just quickly pop on a view. Simple as that. And it's bringing that connection closer to young people and their parliament. They don't have to come into a big session like this. They don't have to write big, long screeds of information, pop a couple of sentences on a platform. And that's fantastic. So, yeah, quite a lot of good experiences.
Great. Thanks, Liam. In fact, we'll go backwards in terms of... Sorry.
And to pick up on Liam's very astute point about time, if it's all right with you, Tess... Can I get Bob just to introduce his question, which is also slightly where yours was going, and might allow us to try and identify possibly some solutions. Bob.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. I'll give a very brief context to it. So there's a consensus that during COVID there's been great opportunities taken to improve equalities, but every measure that's taken can in itself inadvertently create some forms of inequality. We've heard some of that already about remote is great, but if your device isn't as good as someone else's or your broadband connection's not as good. So have there been any equalities issues specifically about the changes? Things can get better, but inequalities between different groups can still increase. So don't we need to roll my second question together, yes, Martin? Because rather than just putting on record what these inequalities might be, any thoughts that you might have to addressing them? So one example about an inequality could be on broadband. Could there be could the Parliament give a book a specific suite where there's good internet connectivity close to where the person lives to make sure there's no issues with connectivity or house space? And final thing, Martin, cause just in case I don't come back in on this, what I was thinking about, and I think it was Artemis and Bill both mentioned this, if you've got caring responsibilities, it's great that you can do that from home, or if you're remote and rural, that you can do that from home. But it shouldn't cut off your ability to come to the Parliament. So could there be some inequalities around, well, it's difficult to get you to Parliament, just you go remote, and therefore there's an inequality that emerges in relation to that, and how can we address some of that stuff? Perhaps simply because I name-checked Artemis and Bill, we should give them the opportunity to come in. Convener, Bill, do you want to go first?
Yeah, I think you're right. I did touch on one of the inequalities issues that continues to exist, is that there are, you know, a fair proportion of disabled people who are not connected to the internet at all, about 30%. About one in three have no internet connection at home. And therefore, to a large extent, during the pandemic, they've been excluded from participation. So we do want to see a hybrid model going forward so that there is the option, at least for those people who don't have an internet connection to come into the parliament, if that's what they want to do. But I think your suggestion as well, that if there were suites available, or you know, local third sector partners like GSIs who could provide space where people could come in, get a good internet connection and give their evidence still not far from home to Parliament, that would also be a good option. Although in that situation, if you've no internet connection, you may be unfamiliar with using a computer, so you might need some support in doing so. Or you might have a physical or sensory impairment that makes it difficult. So those sort of issues would need to be taken into account. And there are still a proportion of disabled people and those with long-term health issues who will only be able to participate remotely, which is another reason why this hybrid forum should go forward, because I've got ex-colleagues who are still isolating at home because if they contracted COVID, it would still be life-threatening because of their compromised immune system. There's definitely a need for a hybrid model going forward, and to continue to take those equalities issues for particularly disabled people, but many older people as well find using the internet difficult, etc. So, and I think getting back to this building relations, I think again the opportunity to meet somebody in person, an MSP who represents you, either your area or an issue that you're particularly interested in, being able to do that face to face, that opportunity should still exist. I think the Parliament has always been much more open than Westminster, which I'm also familiar with working with, and I think it's built on that during the pandemic, and so I hope that that sort of openness continues, because I take on board what Liam said. The committee rooms can be intimidating for people the first time they see them, but what I often find when people do come into the Parliament with myself and other policy team members from Inclusion Scotland, is that they find the place very welcoming and open. So again, I'm looking forward to being able to continue to bring people to Parliament as well, and actually see the place, that where the decisions are made that affect their lives. I do think the Parliament has been good about being open in the past, and I think online provides more access than there was before. So, it's a very positive development.
Thank you, Bill. I know Mari wants to come in, but Artemis, would you like to come in since you got a mention in the question?
Very quickly, thank you. I agree with everything Bill said. We need to offer people choice and financial resources if they want to come to Parliament in person, and not create a tiered approach. That would be a disaster. And two more small things. One, this move of Parliament to regard civil society organisations as partners in public participation is critical, because it is our role as civil society organisations to facilitate participation on an individual basis, and we can work with our members and provide that flexible support so that they can access things. The third thing I want to say very quickly is that very, very small changes sometimes can make enormous difference. So some of our members have asked whether they can provide very short video recordings as evidence on this platform, for example. Some of our members would probably much rather interact with you through the chat, and also some of our members would probably benefit from the ability to be able to phone in, and that system sometimes creates the most kind of inequality in participation on the day, the phone-in system.
Just before I bring Mari in, can I just ask Artemis, is your request really based on the fact that it is the Parliament that should be at its most versatile with regard to what we are calling hybrid interaction, rather than place any expectation on those that we seek contributions from? Would that be an ideal solution?
I think it's a bit of both. And as I said, there's a role there for ourselves as organisations that have members who all individually have their own voice and views and experiences to broker that mutual understanding. Does that answer the question?
Thank you for that, Artemis. Mari, I know that you wanted to come in, and then I think Charis has a contribution. Mari?
Yeah, it's just a few points, because I think you were particularly interested to hear what could be done, or what has to some extent been potentially building on. Maybe I'm leading to another question, but I think we touched on the inequalities. I'm not going to labour those points, though I agree with all of them. But I also think we can't lose sight of the fact that we've seen some phenomenal changes in the last 18 months, some really positive changes. And some inspiring stories, actually, particularly within our older people, within some of our communities with certain disabilities within Highlands anyway. We've seen some really, really great engagement. But the problem from an inequalities perspective is that some of the interventions that support individuals are not sustainable. We saw a number of really good digital engagement programmes brought in early on, but the positivity of that isn't sustainable, because the long-term longevity of what was being put in place wasn't necessarily thought about at the time. I think when we're putting in instances of interventions to support better equality engagement, particularly around digital engagement, we need to think about how we sustain that over a period of time. Giving somebody a fully paid up dongle so that they've got internet access for 18 months is great, but what do they do after 18 months once they've built up a dependency to being online, if they can't afford to bring the dongle in themselves? So there's that. I really like Bill's idea of the hubs, and that might be something that we could explore within the third sector as a structure, and to support better engagement with the Parliament, because although remote and rural area communities, the digital option allows them to not have to travel to Parliament, it may not actually be viable for them to undertake an engagement session like this within their own home. What are other opportunities that we could explore with creating sort of localised hub points where they could get that support digitally, especially if they're unfamiliar with it? And I couldn't support more the concept of hybrid, but one of the things I think that the Parliament could potentially do is either to lead by example or to be more explicit in the guidance around how we bring in a functioning hybrid model and define what is an option for digital engagement, digital sessions, digital meetings, and what is better to be led by an in-person meeting, and how do we blend those together? Although I don't envy the task in finding the answer to that.
Thank you, Maris. Charis, you wanted to add a comment.
Yeah, it was just to draw out for digital exclusion. I think for people on low incomes, that's a real issue as well. I think particularly as we're seeing a rise in cost of living, the first thing to go for people is broadband. It's seen as a non-essential or kind of something that is a bit more flexible. So I think that's something that we need to bear in mind looking at hybrid going forward. I think for us, there's been a couple of examples, both of difficulties and of good practice. So we had one client that took part in the evidence session in November, who didn't have access to the right equipment or to broadband, so they travelled to the house of their deaf coach and did the session from there, which was a positive experience, but it's just recognising, I guess, the additional barrier that creates for that individual. Whereas another individual who was taking part had been given a laptop, an iPad, through Connecting Scotland, and that enabled them to take part more with a variety of different things that were happening and on a more regular basis as well, because they had that access and also had access to skills development and training as part of that. The final thing I just wanted to highlight as well was just as part of those kind of processes, our experts by experience were given the opportunity to claim expenses around broadband or data usage, but that is actually a really quite a complicated process to go through in practice. So it's just whatever we can do to simplify that for people, I think, is really, really important going forward as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Charis. Liam, did you want to?
Yeah, thank you. Just to pick up on a couple of comments that were made, I think you'd made the one about is the onus on Parliament to reach out. And I think there is, as Artemis said, there's that kind of two-way street. But you know, what's really key is that Parliament doesn't go, yeah, it's on us, and doesn't engage with those that it's trying to reach out to, because that's really important, because needs naturally needs change as well. Digital access was discussed quite heavily, as you'd expect. But there's also the run-up to that. So in emails, when papers are sent out, or is there something that says click on this link for more information? These are also things that need to be considered. It's not just about the meeting itself. It's the run-up as well. And two key elements that actually pick up quite regularly with young people on the digital front is the privacy element. Not every young person has somewhere in their home that they can go and sit that's private for them to give evidence. There's also body image concerns. A lot of young people struggle online because they can see their own face and they can see themselves constantly. You don't get that in person. So that is a serious consideration that young people go, I don't want to engage with online because they've got body image concerns as well. Yeah, I'll leave it there because of time.
Thank you, Liam. Kimberly, is there anything that you want to add?
Yes, so just to echo what Liam said about the privacy issue, that's also an issue for people that are perhaps bringing to Parliament experiences that are very raw and challenging. So what I would say for that is more informal engagement, I think, would be really beneficial to some of those organisations. So those engagement sessions that we saw for the Health Inequalities Inquiry, having that private space to interact with MSPs and give that lived experience is really important. Because, as you say, it can be quite intimidating to, you know, I imagine, see yourself on camera, but also, you know, be in this room. So, yes, more informal engagement. And then the other thing that Bill sort of already mentioned was engaging with the third sector and giving them the resources to bring people to Parliament. So, again, the Participation and Communities team, I think, have a really important role and already play a really important role in that. But it's really just enabling people to engage through that community angle, I think, would be really important. And then on the thing that you were mentioning about Parliament reaching out, I think Parliament has a really important role to reach out. And one of the things that I think has been missing, and you'll know better than I whether this has come back, is committee visits to the community for as part of inquiries. I think that's something that's been really missed and something that brings more people to Parliament that might not have thought to engage in an inquiry. Not everyone's sitting on the Parliament website, you know, looking at what the Health Committee is looking into. So it would be really great to see those return at some capacity as well.
Thank you, Kimberly. I'm going to pass up to a great advocate of committee visits. Colette, would you like to...
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and good morning. And it's lovely to meet you all online and in person as well. So thank you very much. I wanted to touch upon the accessibility, what we've done so far. So would you like to see any of these changes continue? And one of the things, maybe, how can we actually enhance that or tweak it maybe? And some of you have touched upon it. So taking that into consideration today, there's six of you here, there's four online, and there's two here. Do you think that's the right balance? So just to sort of contextualise, or is there anything else that we can do to enhance your journey to interact with us here in Parliament? And I think I'll go to Liam first. Thanks.
Great. Yeah, thank you. I mean, it's been discussed a lot, very positive experience over the past 18 months. And I think there is quite a lot to... Main call is, let's keep hybrid proceedings, would be our main call. I think there is areas for kind of making that enhanced, as you discussed. Lead-in time would be a big one, so requests through to attend at committees and the papers coming through is a really significant thing for SYP as well, because as an organisation, we never want to come to Parliament and go, this is my opinion. We want to say, this is the opinion of Scotland's young people. And we can't do that if we have a day or two's notice of what the questions will be, what the papers are. If we have over a week's notice, we can give you some of the best data we could possibly get from children and young people across Scotland. And naturally, I'm assuming that's what the Parliament would want as well. There is one key element you discussed about this element, and it's not happening today, which is lovely, is tokenism is a really big concern. The young people we'd provide would be volunteers. I'm not sure colleagues stay us around the room, but a lot of the time they go into meetings with those that are paid, and they're in full-time positions, etc. And, you know, we need to really consider that the value we place on volunteers' time. And I know we have discussed that, but is there maybe an aspect of purely a volunteer session? So it's a two or three people, you're getting that data as quick as you possibly can that you require for whatever you're researching or inquiring on, and then you move on, and then you can move on to others. Now, not devaluing those time if they are paid, of course. It's just about, you know, six colleagues here today. Would that have been more efficient for those giving evidence if it was two sessions of three that were half the time? Something along those lines. Just to, again, think about that time element. But I'll leave it there. I'm sure others have great contributions as well.
Thanks, Liam. And can I go to Charis and ask Charis what her thoughts are on that?
Yeah, I think for us, what we really value is just is continued learning. So I think the opportunity for people, particularly where there's a lived experience session, for people to input into that afterwards to grow and to learn and to a commitment to continual improvement around that. I think that is a really key part of it. I think something we found really valuable in the current inquiry we're taking part in is we've been having a hybrid approach even to how we do that. So having online sessions with the people taking part to gather together, to get to know each other before coming into that experience. And then they're due to come into Parliament on the 6th of June to meet with the committee at that point. So they've had a lot of kind of preparation and investment in that time beforehand. And then I think what will be really important after that is to gather their feedback and their experience and then to a commitment to continual review and learning as part of the process.
Well, that's good to know. Can I also put the same question to Bill as well? Thanks.
Yeah, I echo everything Charis has just said. I'm giving quite a bit of thought to what Liam said. You know, this is my job. It's a job I love. It doesn't cost me anything in terms of attending a committee session or coming in to see an MSP or minister. But I am very aware, you know, although we never have any problem in getting disabled people to come forward and give evidence, that is partially because over half of disabled people of working age are not in work. And therefore, they do have time that they can give. I think that time should still be valued and rewarded if at all possible. So I'm very much in favour of paying people for the time they give. But there are a large section of the population who obviously attending a committee session or a cross-party group is time out of their working day. And that means it's costing them to come into Parliament and give evidence. And that's something I think should be, you know, more thought should be given to going forward. How can we involve people so that you get the full breadth of the experience? Because we've been talking about the importance of lived experience, but, you know, there are people in low-paid jobs, there are people in jobs where they've been harassed or discriminated against, who find it difficult to give evidence, both financially and in some instances because it would endanger the jobs. So the opportunity to give evidence in private to committee sessions. I've done that in the past over bullying of young disabled people in school, where we had a couple of young people who wanted to give evidence but would not have been comfortable giving that evidence at all in public about the ways that they were humiliated whilst they were at school. So I think there are things you can still do to tweak things to make sure that Parliament is genuinely open and accessible to everyone, and that you're hearing full breadth of experiences that you need to hear when you're conducting committee inquiries.
Okay, thank you. I'm obviously conscious of time, but if any of the others want to come in, and I don't want to exclude any of you either.
Artemis would like to contribute. Artemis.
Thank you. Just very quickly, and building on what everybody else said, I guess a word of caution would be that we need to be mindful that the more informal, flexible and relaxed the session, the more accessible that session probably is to a wider range of people. But conversely and frequently, what we find is that the less value we as kind of decision makers, policy makers, society pay to the information that comes out of these informal, flexible, relaxed sessions compared to the formal, heavy, minuted committees. And so I think it is about paying attention to any trade-off between access and the power of people who participate. And I do like Mari's suggestion of kind of like hybrid or participation standards that the Parliament has that are quite transparent. I'm sorry, Mari, if I've just put words into your mouth, but that's the way I understood your statement. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Sue, I know a lot has been covered, but is there anything that...
I think there has been a lot covered, and I just want to thank Kimberly for recognising how those four sessions went on Friday, Monday, and to address some of the concerns from Artemis there, the trade-off, the information that we gain from those informal sessions will very much shape our formal inquiry going forward. So to me, the thing that is about getting that richer evidence and involving many more people, and it was Mary that said it's not just the well-kent faces, and I think if this is something that allows to facilitate that, I think that's something we need to grasp. And how can we really, really capitalise on that and make it even better, I suppose, is the one thing. And so any changes that can make it and make it even easier to engage than we've already done, would be my point. Well, I'm going to ask Liam, if that's OK, because I'm looking at you.
Yes, no, that's fine. I mean, as we've discussed quite a lot, and I know a lot of colleagues will want to come in with more. There's a lot of discussion about the informal sessions, but that is really rich for young people. An example that kind of improved it, and a good example on feedback as well, is that last session, the Education Committee wanted feedback on education work over COVID, and it was going to be a session much like this on the platform you use online, and young people went, "Oh, I don't know how to use that," and there was all this concern, and they changed to Teams. And young people know what Teams is because they've had to go through a year of it in school. So they adapted very quickly to that, and the Parliament adapted really quickly to that. And it's that kind of change, that feedback, that if one of the witnesses or someone you want to hear from says, "Oh, I can't do that day," or I've got a test that day, I can't come out of school, or I'm sure other examples will be given, how can Parliament adapt to that and to get that information out? Because what will work for one person, one young person, I'll say in our example, will not work for another young person. A lot of, for example, myself, been battered around this sort of fear for a couple of years now, so kind of getting used to how to fit it in. But for some young people, it is a barrier. You come in, you've got people in suits, you've got bright lights, and you sit and you think, "Geez, oh, what am I doing here?" And we don't want that. We want people to go, "Oh, this is cool. I get to make a bit of a change here." And the really key element that comes into play here is when a young person is given evidence, given their time to share their opinions, that the Parliament and decision makers are going back and saying, "This is what we've done with your information. This is why it's valued." And that is the key element here.
I think, Mari, you wanted to come in?
Yeah, thank you. It was just a couple of points, I suppose. I think we've got to think about this as building relationships to some extent, and I don't think I would be so off the mark to say that when you're further away from Holyrood, it is less a part of your working culture on a day-to-day basis, less part of actually just the culture in general. It's something that happens down there. It's not necessarily something that belongs to me in my community. And I hope that I'm not misrepresenting things, but I think that is a situation. So when you do informal engagement sessions, I think it actually brings a consciousness of actually what's going on at Holyrood, how that works, how the Parliament functions, who the people are, what is a committee, what is an inquiry. It brings a lot of that much more to the forefront. And without that necessarily being in the conscious mindset, I think there's an awful lot of people who think, "Well, why would I? How is it relevant to me?" And that's how we end up to some extent getting, particularly, I think, for remote and rural areas, those well-kept basis, because they're the individuals who've taken an active participation in it. So the informal sessions, the visiting communities, getting out and about makes a phenomenal difference in terms of preparing that cultural landscape for participation in what's going on. One of the things I would say, though, is to bearing in mind that we can still use digital for geographic engagement. I'm not sure how it always plays out, but if the choice is that we don't get a committee, we don't get a visit from an investigation or an inquiry or something like that into a remote and rural community because they won't be able to make the physical journey to it, it's just not economically viable or it's not possible based on calendars, using a digital alternative is still better than nothing at all. And so actually making sure that we do use those alternatives as a way to engage even in a geographical sense is still something I would encourage you to think about.
So,
that's great. It's just if there's anybody else wants to come in. If not, I think I'm not sure if anyone else does.
Kimberly?
Just, I'll be really brief, but just in terms of what the Parliament could do, I think going forward, it'd be really great if the Parliament could take a lead on this. So be flexible, be creative and ambitious, because I think a lot of organisations are going through the exact same challenges that the Parliament is going through and will be looking to the Parliament for that ambition. So it would be great to see some more in-person events coming back. We know that people really benefited from that in the past. We had a member of the Health Inequalities CPG prior to COVID, Scott Granger, who sadly passed away, but we know from him that it meant a real difference coming to Parliament and actually having that gravitas, being in the building, engaging with MSPs and ministers directly. It made a real difference to him. So I think to lose that would be a real shame, but also balancing that with being online as well. So just would urge ambition if possible.
Can I just push you slightly on that point, Kimberly, because we've discussed very much the sort of the committees, the CPGs, the other areas of interactions. One of the comments that has been made on a number of occasions from different sources, and it picks up on your view of the word gravitas, that the hybrid method that we use reduces the gravitas and the importance of this Parliament. Would you agree with that, or do you think it's something that we should be cogent of and guard against, or actually do you think we are moving into a time when, you know, from those who are outside that engage with the Parliament, you're fully aware of the importance of the Parliament, and actually perhaps you need the Parliament to be aware of its own importance at times?
Yes. So actually, just adding to what Liam said, I think it is entirely within the power of MSPs to bring that gravitas online. So really grateful to Sue sort of highlighting that those informal evidence sessions off camera that were all online will shape the direction of a committee inquiry. That's a huge deal, and that brings gravitas to that engagement. So I don't think it's just the building. The building plays a big role, but actually MSP's role in feeding back on what they have heard, that I think that's where the gravitas really comes from.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Mari, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I think that's really interesting, actually. I haven't heard that, but I'm not surprised it has been raised. I think actually that's potentially a sign that we're doing things right and that you're doing things right, because we're changing the model and shape of things, and it's making people feel a bit uncomfortable with that change from something that they're used to. So I don't agree that the hybrid model reduces the gravitas. I think actually what it demonstrates is that we have a much more accessible Parliament that's operating and trying to engage with people in different ways and new ways, and it's innovation to some extent that's making people potentially feel a little bit uncomfortable, but I don't think I would agree.
Thank you. Bill, you had a comment?
Yeah, it's actually just a thought, and it's something that we, as an organisation, that disabled people and disabled people's organisations, we've been considering going forward as well. And it is, if you are going out to a geographic area, like the Highlands or Dumfries and Galloway or the Borders, or Gyland Butte, etc., it can still be difficult for people to participate, even though you're in one of the centres. So if you're in Inverness, you're still 3.5 hours away from Skye. I think there's advantages in looking at hybrid methods, even when you're on committee visits to locations, because it enables participation by people who wouldn't otherwise be able to participate, either by reasons of distance or, again, because of disability or other reasons, time-wise. So, thinking about hybrid forums, not just for formal committee sessions in Parliament, but also for those committee visits that I hope we'll see reinstated, I think would be a good tweak going forward to continue to involve as many people as possible from as wide a group as possible within various communities.
Thank you, Bill. And Charis?
Yeah, it was just to pick up on something that Liam was saying there just about barriers and the kind of move over to Teams call there. I think that there's a kind of wider issue there of actually what are the barriers establishing or identifying those barriers before people come in as well, so it doesn't stop them, and what flexibility we can have. I think it's about not necessarily about Parliament having all the flexibility, but about working together to work out how to make it accessible for people. So just I think a couple of things with that would be, for us, we're working with people who are in low income or in debt. That's very stigmatizing. So how can we make it safe for people to give evidence and to take part? So making it sure that they can remain anonymous. Particularly a high number of our clients have maybe come from a situation like domestic abuse where they wouldn't want to be public what they're sharing. So having that kind of flexibility for being anonymous and still taking part. And the other thing as well is being on a low income, the expenses system can be a barrier as well. So yes, it's great that expenses are provided, but people have to make the outlay first and then claim the expense back. And they might not have the income in order to do that. So how can we remove that barrier for people as well?
Thank you, Charis. And can I thank everyone who's attended today? Because for the first time in my experience as convener, I get the opportunity to say we have the slightest amount of time left if there is anything that any of those who are attending, not the committee, would like to put on the record, which we could pursue in correspondence afterwards. So I'm just going to go around the room. Artemis, is there anything that you would like to have been able to discuss but have not been able to raise it?
No, I think that was very comprehensive, but I will add my voice to Charis's and say participation fees for us would be something we would welcome as well.
Bill?
No, really nothing to add. I think my fellow participants in this panel have been very good at highlighting the other issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Mari?
No, nothing. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Charis?
I think that's covered everything for me as well. Thank you.
Excellent. Kimberly, can I come to you?
So just one very small thing. The Participation in Communities team, I hope that the committee will be hearing from them as part of this inquiry. But I believe also there are other inquiries happening in Parliament on participation. So, and I'm hoping those will all link up to do with witness diversity. And I think there's a form that goes out to witnesses to gather diversity information. I think there were a couple of things that we would want added to that. One of them would be education, and then the other would be caring responsibilities. I don't know if that is something that's a possibility, but it'd be really good at this. It would be such an interesting time to gauge who's engaging with the Parliament and how that can be improved. So I think those two things really, really key. And we welcome that so many more organisations and people can engage with Parliament. Primarily, we think, because of the Participation in Communities team. So really, really grateful for that. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Kimberly. Liam?
Yeah, very quickly as well, I suppose. We've discussed engagement a lot, and that word is so unbelievably important. It can't be understated enough. I suppose last call would be, if you're ever in doubt about how to engage with a young person, ask them. There's nothing, that's as simple as it goes. They'll happily tell you, no doubt about it. I think the most dangerous statement that could be uttered in this Parliament is, we've always done it this way. Try and engage and find out a way that works for everybody. Thank you very much for inviting young people to the table as well.
No, thank you for that. And I think that phrase shouldn't just apply to young people, but perhaps should apply to anyone. Why not just try asking them? Can I thank you all for attending today, both hybrid and in person? I found it a very, very positive meeting. I'm glad the technology stood up, which is always the fear that people of my generation seem to have at this. But can I very much thank you for your time? And if there is anything that subsequently comes to your mind, please feel free to write in. Our inquiry is ongoing, but we're moving to that stage where we're going to be considering conclusions. So, can I thank you for your attendance today, and I'm now going to close the public part of this meeting.